irony wasn't lost on anyone that a man who lived for his music would be found dead at the foot of Beale Street where he'd performed before. 30-year-old Jeff Buckley disappeared last week after a friend saw him jump into the Mississippi fully clothed. Despite several searches by police, it was a tourist on the American Queen ready to set sail on a cruise for St. Louis who finally spotted Buckley's body.
For the past several months, Buckley liked coming here to Barristers. He performed here Monday nights. It's an underground club located in a back alley in downtown Memphis, underneath a parking garage surrounded by graffiti.
Not only did Buckley make Memphis his home recently, he also had plans to cut his next album here. That won't happen now, and his friends say that's everybody's loss. Richard Ransom, Action News 5.
Walking out of the house in the morning and see him on the street, and he would have been up all night walking around and just checking out things, and then he would go inside and he let his lawn grow well over knee high and would go around and ask me for a lawnmower, knowing full well I didn't have a lawnmower, because he just got a kick out of having a lawn, and he would lay in it at night. He would push the tall grass aside and lay in it and look up at the stars.
The mystery is that it's a language for something that has no language. It's an expression for something that just can't be expressed, but it is expressed. It's just the existence of music is totally audacious.
Even if I was just tired, I would sit down and play. And whenever I would play, the boys would come and be in the room where the piano was. They liked it. They would ask for songs. After I was done and I was getting ready to get up from the piano, they'd say, "No, Mommy, stay. Play another one." And usually it was Scotty or Jeff who said, "Oh, play the one that sounds like raindrops," or play the waltz, Mommy, or something that he liked about it. He would give it a special name, whether it was really Beethoven or Rachmaninoff or someone else. I think in sixth grade, he was given a choice to play in the orchestra and asked what he would like to play, and I think he chose the cello, and they loaned him a cello to play, and I even have a photograph of that. It's pretty priceless.
Actually, I never lived in a trailer, but it's still that sort of...
Yeah, you self-described yourself? You described yourself as rootless trailer trash.
Yeah, I mean, virtually. Basic, way lower, working class, white boy desert town sort of. No culture, no class, no nothing.
Is that good for music?
All my experience feeds my music, but it's just where I come from.
Somehow, people think that we lived in a trailer park and that we were poor white trailer trash. And I think Jeff might even have said something like that in an interview, something that led them to believe that. We did move around a lot because as a single mom and the changing job market, I was always shifting around to try and make do or do better. The family chipped in together to buy Jeff his first, you know, real guitar. And, grandma, aunt, and uncle, and the Les Paul that we bought him for Christmas was his pride and joy.
What is love?
I turned my cheek when I was coming up in the school system in California, and all I had was all my stuff stolen, had my ass kicked. And I said, forget about it. I'm going to fight back. I'm going to go crazy, and I'm going to kill you. But I'd never, like, go out and hurt anybody. Ever. Ever in my life.
Well, I know he decided when he was 17 and a half and graduated from high school that he wasn't going to be going to college or doing anything else. He had an idea that he wanted to go after, and that he would go to Musicians Institute, and that he wouldn't just mess around trying to develop any other skill or a fallback plan. He knew he wanted to be a musician. He worked for an answering service, and he was a night clerk at a hotel, and he was, a clerk at a clothing store. Nothing to do with music, and not what he wanted to be doing at all.
There was a drummer in my band that was friends with Jeff, and he goes, I know this great guitar player, you should have him come and play. And he came to a show that we were having, and I realized that I'd already met this guy. It was Jeff. He was really good friends with a drummer. They had done some gigs together. So he ended up joining the band, and just an amazing guitar player. That's how I thought of Jeff at that time. The band was called Group Therapy, and we were together about 3 years. Jeff was in the band about 3 years. We did a lot of shows. And I kind of saw him blossom during this time. He was kind of shy at first. And I think in this band, he really learned how to be himself. He learned to sing. Or learned to not be so nervous about singing, because he definitely could already sing. He's an excellent singer. And he also, around this time, started writing. Jeff's taste in music was so diverse. He liked the Smiths. He liked heavy metal. Anything from heavy metal to opera. He just liked everything. He would listen to it and absorb everything. And that's kind of unusual for a musician. Usually you choose kind of one or two styles that you like, but he was just open to every single thing. That's why his music is so wonderful.
I'm coming out.
much from his mother. His Mary explored into a lot of different music. One of his favorite bands was Led Zeppelin, and he told us a story how he would drive around in his mother's boyfriend's van. He had a VW van, and it had big speakers in the back. And he would lie on a platform, and they would drive around, and Led Zeppelin would be playing at full blast. And he thinks that's how he got so good at playing these songs, because he just heard them so many times, he just absorbed them from laying in the back of the van, listening to the music so loud. Yeah, he was kind of on his own. He really was kind of against the crowd. He didn't really get into sports. He wasn't into the beach. He didn't really get into the girls, really. You know, he really just wanted to be an artist, even at a young age. And I think he decided at 8 years old he was going to be a musician forever. So probably I could see why his childhood would be hard, you know. For anyone that's a little bit different and you don't fit in, it is hard.
His ambition, I can remember one night in particular, we were sitting in my studio in North Hollywood working on an endless demo, which was what Jeff and I would do, and he looked at me and I asked him, what is it you want to do 5 years from now? Where do you want to be? He said, I want to make an album that makes people forget about Led Zeppelin 2. My first meeting with Jeff was sometime in the late 80s, probably around 1988, when I was actually producing, I had co-written a song that I was producing with an R&B act in Los Angeles, and we were doing the demo. And one of the members of the band told me there was this great young guitar player that was in town, and that maybe we could get him and we could use him. I believe he wore some sort of leather jacket or something. It was just the guy that walked in there looked like something out of maybe a Lower East Side, early 70s CBGB's kind of gunslinger, as opposed to, and he did not look like one of the LA late 80s guitar players, let's put it that way. And he was, the minute he plugged in, Jeff came to life. Very quiet, very reserved. When he plugged in, you couldn't stop him.
I'm not,
an artist isn't separate from a person who isn't or doesn't feel they're an artist. You know, there's artistry in human beings. It's just a human function. I find answers from music all the time, but because I've most identified with music as a way of expressing myself, I just find most of my answers there. Other people find it through painting or art or teaching or murder.
You know, I love jazz, and I got a lot of love of improv from things like Duke Ellington and Miles and arrangement and pacing. But basically, all that music comes from moving people in a live setting. Live meaning not on television, live meaning not on the radio, live meaning you are there, there are some people there in a performance space, and they are moving the hell out of you.
I had moved to Los Angeles from New York, so he had constantly asked me questions. I'd lived in Manhattan prior to moving to Los Angeles. He constantly asked me questions about Manhattan. As a matter of fact, to this day, I still have one of the first letters he ever sent to me when he moved, and even though he had yet to find a job, he didn't know where he was going or what he was doing, he was happy. He was very happy. He was in New York. He needed to come here. This was his Mecca. He needed to come to New York.
Well, the first time Jeff played in New York for a larger audience, it was at St. Anne's Church, and that was a tribute for his father, Tim Buckley. And what was sort of funny about that is that he didn't really know his father that well, had only met him one time before in his life when he was about 9 years old.
It was 1991, and we were working with a record producer named Hal Wilner, and Hal and the program director here, Janine Nichols, wanted to do a tribute to Tim Buckley. I think I told you before how wonderful the acoustics are in here, and very, very special performing space, and we thought Tim's music would be perfect for being celebrated in this space. So Janine and Hal started to work on it to bring together a number of musicians who could interpret Tim Buckley's music. And during the investigation and the research, one of the things that we found out was that there was a son, Jeff, who was a musician.
Think through one of his managers or early publishers, we were told he had a son, and I think they were talking to Janine, and I remember the conversation went something like, he has a son who's a singer and guitarist and songwriter, and I went, is he any good? And the guy went, damn, much better than Tim. Whenever that was the reaction, was what we heard, so it was, oh, okay, and we were back and forth, should we, about it, you know, didn't know whether to invite him, and he took it upon himself to call St. Anne's. I believe he called there, answered the phone, and he said something like, this is Jeff, period. I mean, oh, Jeff, who? And I heard about this conversation. He was given my phone number, and I got the same phone call. So, hi, this is Jeff. But I didn't have to ask who. So.
And, you know, maybe it was therapeutic in the sense that a door was open in him, you know, that he now had to deal with, because he was now making music in a very public way. And especially at the very beginning here, people were comparing him to his father. So he had, and from what I understand, that haunted him his whole life. You know, he used to say, you know, I'd be sweating, you know, I'd be put on a really long and tiring show and just killing myself. You know, and I'd come off stage and someone would come up to me and go, oh, I knew your father, you know. And he didn't like being compared to him. But I think he also began to embrace the part of his dad that was in him. And I think it was really through the music.
Well, now it's just the same old story. Nothing about love for glory. A nickel and a dime, a dozen things. Oh, it's such a shame.
It did become his concert. We even sent him out there to do an encore by himself.
Long time ago, when I was a little kid, my mom sat on a bed and she put this record on. And it's like the first song I ever heard that had my father's voice. I must have been 6. Once I was a hunter. And I brought home fresh meat for you. Once I was a lover.
Everyone, all these people were giving him business cards afterwards. And he then, I think, just, he was in tears after the show. I remember going back, he's actually crying, you know. And he had fallen in love. You know, Rebecca, the show, and this is where he was going to live. And he, you know, he had, within the course of that one show, been accepted by almost every musical grouping in New York, every musical area. So everyone just adopted him, and it just became a natural thing for him to want to come here. I mean, you know, it's sort of like he walked into a new life.
Hanoi, Vietnam, November 14. Up a musty stairwell in a museum commemorating the triumph of the People's Army of Vietnam. A team of American investigators sit hunched over laptop computers and a camera tripod.
He came back to Los Angeles because there was something going on with the estate of his father that brought his father's old manager back into the picture, and apparently he had financed the 4-song demo for Jeff at a studio in Los Angeles that Herb Cohen apparently had set up to get. Jeff came back and had these 4 songs, 2 of which would become Eternal Life. And Last Goodbye.
Yeah, this is our last goodbye. I hate to feel the love between us die. But it's over. Just in this and then I'll go. You gave me more than it's for. More than you'll ever know. Last
a song about a dream.
Started to feel the power of his voice was when he would do shows around here, you know, at Chennai, and do his songs and do cover songs, and you know, then it was apparent that it was one. I mean, I think he was the best white singer since, you know, John Lennon and Richard Manuel.
That, you know, I wanted to give some sense of what the whole room is like, so I got this panoramic camera, and I got up on the ladder so I could see the whole room, and he was just sitting. I think that photograph actually shows a lot of his sense of humor, because I think that's an hysterical picture. Like, he's sitting there looking up in the air, there's the people are sitting there, they're not even looking at him playing, you know, and he's just like, and I think it just shows this incredible sense of humor that he chose that picture to be his album cover, because, you know, it's true, though, like, the guy that was sitting there was just, he was reading his newspaper, and he was just like, I think he's this old Irish guy, and he's just sitting there, and he was like reading his paper, and nobody was paying any attention to him whatsoever, and it's like, I don't know, it was very funny. I thought that was great. I was really glad he chose that.
It's live solo. It's four songs taken from like 5.5 hours of live material, you know, my originals and weird old songs.
Tell us about these weird old songs, because it's quite an eclectic selection.
Well, it all has to do with hero worship. Either it's like, you know, Bad Brains or Edith Piaf or Nina Simone or Judy Garland or John Lee Hooker or, you know.
Do you still live there?
Yeah, I always will. Actually, technically, no, I don't. I'm a little bit above, I'm on the cusp of the area, but that's where I hang out.
Why is that great for you?
It's just an artistic community. It's where all the freaks go and live and thrive and create. And and live doing it. And there's a large amount of people there. And in below Soho and around Soho, it's in Tribeca, where it's all over the place, but usually lower down in New York, people totally intoxicated with their own eccentricity. And I appreciate that. I think it makes sense.
Would have been about 92. He came to see my band, Shudder to Think, that I was playing lead guitar for in, I believe it was Washington, D.C., at a club called the 930 Club. He was with we were both on Sony Records, and we were on Epic, and he was on Columbia. And he had just been signed, and I knew who his father was, and I heard that he was this big talent. And he was just really effusively into the band and into the music that I was doing, and was just extremely drunk, and was, you know, very sweet, and he was so sort of drunk and sweaty and good looking that I kind of, thought he was a great, thought he was an interesting character, but I kind of dismissed stupidly the idea that he could be super talented because he just was so good looking. You know what I mean? And that prejudice immediately sort of kicked in. He had just mastered, or he was just in the process of mastering Grace.
Could keep track of what he was listening to. There never seemed to be that much reason for it. It just kind of like came and went out of his life. But he did discover Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan around that time. And there was a really wonderful afternoon. It's actually my favorite memory of him. And we went, we were driving around. I had a little tiny red car, and we were driving around giving out flyers for a concert that we were doing here. I was probably paying, $6 an hour or something to drive around with me, and it was a really dark winter day, and it was raining and cold, and so we had the windows all rolled up, and we're sitting in this tiny car, and we're listening to Joni Mitchell records. I know them all by heart, and he of course knows them by heart, and so we were sitting in the car singing Coyote things for Coyote at the top of our lungs, and to hear his, I can carry it too, I keep up, but, to hear his voice in this tiny car was just so fantastic, and we just sang all afternoon and threw flyers out the window, and at some point he took out this Nusrat tape that he had bought on the street for a dollar or something, and puts it in the deck and starts singing. He's doing this Kavali singing, and he, in a sort of, pigeon Urdu, he's just you know, it's just sound to him. I don't think he had a sense of what it was about, what the music was about yet, but he could sing it. He could really sing it. And it was the first time I'd ever heard that music at all, much less, you know, its greatest practitioner.
If you couldn't make music,
yeah,
would you go crazy?
I would be completely insane. Or I'd take up sculpture. And if I didn't have sculpture, I'd take up screenplays. If I didn't have that, I'd take up something else. Anything artistic. But music seems to me to be the most closely identified with my soul. I mean, I feel that it's the best for me. It just gets into the bloodstream so quickly, for no reason at all. You can close your heart and you can sleep even with your eyes closed, but you can never close your ears.
He would listen back and inevitably, as good as it was to those of us who were in the room with him, some of the stuff was just breathtaking. It was so good that we didn't want to erase it. And Jeff's habit was to listen to it and inevitably want to do it again and do it again. In a few takes, I didn't even want to erase where I would put him on another track, and he would wind up doing it better. He was a perfectionist.
Like a live show where you play it and it just disappears into the air like smoke. It's like painting, you know, sound painting, and it's in a, you know, it's like a crystallized form. So it's very nerve wracking. Like which brain cell do I put down here forever and ever? I, you know, you don't know. It's and half of the art of making records is letting the whole thing go. You know, even your mistakes. Grace is what matters in anything, especially life, especially growth, tragedy, pain. Love, death, about people, that's what matters. That's a quality I admire very greatly. It keeps you from reaching for the gun too quickly. It keeps you from destroying things too foolishly. It sort of keeps you alive. And it keeps you open for more understanding.
Jeff felt very comfortable on the road, moving around and performing every night. That was, you know, a home for him that combined the elements that, you know, helped balance him. That was, yeah, he loved that. And I loved that, too.
Snorting! Oh, I said dumb beer.
He was a, he had two identities. He had two, sort of forces within him. He was the guy that you knew, as I said, you know. Who was a goofy guy who liked to joke around and was, you know, like your crazy friend, and was you know, like a really spontaneous kind of comedian, and
you know. And then, but then he was just had this musical persona that was sort of unearthly, and it was very strange to observe. But but both of these aspects were equally him, and they were, you know. He wasn't an angelic figure. He was a person who was just had this amazing ability. It was almost like it wasn't his fault. He just did, you know. And,
to be product. He didn't want to be just known as somebody who was put together and packaged and put out there by the label. These were things that record companies had done and continued, and to this day they do with their artists, whether they're promotional shows or whatever it was that Jeff didn't want to do. So I think there was a lot of strife in his life over those things. But again, this was Jeff. Jeff could have been far more successful in the popular sense had he followed the record machine, had he given himself over to that. But Jeff would never do that, you know. Which is why I think today he's more popular overseas than he is in the United States. You know, where less of the hype and more of the artist's talent is on display.
It didn't matter that we did the same songs so much. Every time it was very new for all of us, and he really thrived in that environment of live performance.
Secret chord that David played, and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you? Well, it goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, and the major lift. The baffled king composing hallelujah, hallelujah. Faith was strong, but you needed proof. You saw her bathing on the roof, her beauty and the moonlight overthrew you. And she tied you to her kitchen chair, she broke your throne and she cut your hand, but from your lips she drew the hallelujah. This floor, yes, I used to live alone before I knew you. And I've seen your flag on the marble arch, and love is not some victory march, it's a cold and it's a broken hallelujah. A time when you let me know what's really going on below, but now you never show up.
Memphis is the place where Elvis heard black music and from his white background tried to recreate it, and because he had a country and white gospel inflections in his background, the music he made trying to play black music didn't sound like black music. It was something new, and that was rock and roll.
Black train, got my baby and go. Train, coming right to baby.
What brought Jeff to Memphis? He came here because he wanted to make a record, simply. Why did he come here? Because there was a band here called the Grifters that he liked, and he liked the sound they were getting, and he liked the feel of their music, and he wanted to try to get some of that. And I think that when he came here, feel that he found in the city opened up some new ideas to him, and he wanted to stay and explore those because he knew that by exploring that part of him, of himself that he was finding, that it would be reflected in his music.
I think it was more a person thing. I think it was more like Dave, because Dave was sort of one of the main writers in the Grifters, and they had a certain style of mixing sort of a real beautiful melody with a real sort of harsh rhythm section. We were recording live, you know, we just had the band on the floor. Tom Verlaine was down producing, and Tom and Jeff did a lot. You know, they talked a lot about what they were doing. But it was real productive. I mean, they went... typical day was like probably 12 hours or so at least, and it was there's a lot of work, just, you know, not a lot of goofing off or anything. We pretty much worked all the time with little spontaneous little jams in between and stuff. Pretty much, I think it was about 10 days or so, and basically that's what ended up as the Sketches first disc, you know.
Michael Tye, his guitarist, told me that he had called him and said, I have it all in black and white. You all would just supply the colors. He'd been supposedly laboring under a writer's block, and yet out of this writer's block came a long list of songs that he had begun and never finished, and now we're suddenly finishing and fleshing out. You can hear them in the four tracks where he sat laying layers of sound one over another and creating an orchestral sound all by himself in that little place in Memphis.
We would call each other, you know, about once every week, and I would ask about the songs. He said, no, I just really have to reiterate the music's really come to a place like the way it used to be with us. Like, and he was talking about a time where it felt that the music that we were all creating was very important and convicted and special and realized and focused, and he had found that again inside himself. Yeah, that was the last conversation I had with him. Yeah.
And then the last conversation we had was, we talked about my record and I asked him how it's going, and he said that he knew he had, you know, this was at a point where the band had come back to New York, and this was about a week before, I think, and he was just sitting in his place and doing demos on the four track, and said it was going really well, and that he was figuring out stuff and it's making more sense.
He would play songs. He realized people were coming from all over everywhere. He played them things he knew they wanted to hear, but it was mostly the reason he was here was he was working out the songs that were going to be on his new album, or trying to see if they would be on his new album, and he was just working them out in front of a crowd to get a reaction from people or whatnot, you know, what artists do.
Like a suicidal streak, and so it was just a fluke. I mean, like I said, you go down and you look at this water, and it's just you feel like you can, you know, maybe you've had a couple beers, you want to, you know, swim to the other side. It seems like it'd be no problem. It'd be a nice, you know, thing to do in the summer, evening. So, you know, I don't think it, and that was just to people have intimated that though somehow like this suicide, you know, there was this statement, this like dark, you know, like semi-suicide. It just wasn't. It was a fluke. I'm sure of that, if I know him at all.
So around the time that we did go down there, I was definitely feeling as though this was the right time to all be together again. But I also knew that he for himself, he had to be alone and come into something. I didn't expect that it would be that, but now I realize that it was that he had to die.
I had a picture in my mind that was actually a metaphysical image that the true body of my son was not the speck of dust that they pulled out of Wolf River, but the body of his work.
My life is over and my time has run out. My friends and my loved ones, I will leave, there's no doubt. But one thing's for certain, when it comes my time, I leave this whole world, oh yeah, oh yeah, with a satisfied mind. My mind, satisfied mind.